which is the last chapter under the CNS. Okay. So in the last lecture we had continued with the individual drugs, okay, like tramadol, methadone and all. Okay, then the uses we had discussed of the morphine and its congener. So opioid analgesics as a whole, the uses were discussed. Okay. And then we had covered a small part, that is the opioid receptors. So we had seen that there are three opioid receptors, okay, mu, kappa and delta. So we have seen exactly what are the different functions which are mediated through those three receptors. And basically we have seen that it is through these interaction through these opioid receptors, basically that the opioid analgesics, they produce the analgesia or analgesic effect. Okay, and morphine basically it produces the analgesia by interaction through the mu receptor. Okay, then we have also covered what are the transducer mechanisms. Okay, they all are G protein coupled receptors. Okay, then the next part is the complex action opioids and opioid antagonist. Okay, so now why this term is given to this? Why not only opioid antagonist? Okay, so we need to study the blockers also, which can block the actions of these receptors, opioid receptors. But here an additional term, complex action opioids, is given. Okay, that's because though these all these drugs have antagonistic property at one particular opioid receptor, but they may have agonistic property to some other subtype of the opioid receptor. Okay, no doubt they all of them will interact with the opioid receptor only. Okay, but there are few which have pure opioid antagonistic property. Okay, all of them do not only block the opioid receptor, but there are certain drugs which can interact and stimulate these opioid receptors also. Okay, so depending upon what type of action they are showing on these receptors, they are categorized into three basic classes. Okay, the first one is agonist antagonist. So the name itself implies that they will act as agonist also and they will act as antagonist also at a certain subtype of the receptors. Okay, and basically these are called as kappa analgesics because that analgesia is mediated through the kappa agonistic property. Okay, so examples under this are nalorphine, pentazocin, butorphenol. And the second class is partial or weak mu agonist plus kappa antagonist. Okay, so in this particular class, this drug buprenorphine, it has partial or weak mu agonistic property. So it will produce analgesic effect because of its interaction with the mu receptor. We have seen that this mu receptor interaction is a major mechanism for morphine. Okay, so it will produce similar action, but at the same time it has kappa antagonistic action, that is it can block the kappa type of opioid receptor. Okay, so properties will not be same as that of morphine, but it will be different than that. Okay, so this is the only one which is showing such kind of properties. Then the third class is pure antagonist. Okay, so these are the drugs, that is naloxone, naltrexone and nalmefin. These are the three examples which will act as pure antagonists. That is, they will only block all the types of opioid receptors, that is mu, kappa as well as delta receptors are blocked. They don't have any agonistic property towards any of the receptors. Okay, so that's why they are named as pure antagonists. And it is this class which is used as an antidote. Okay, specifically this naloxone, it is used as an antidote in opioid poisoning. Okay, if you can see under the toxicology part, okay, opioid poisoning, you will find this drug which is a specific antidote which can antagonize all the actions of opioid poisoning. Okay, so to start with the individual drugs, the first one is nalorphine. This was the first of opioid antagonists which was discovered. It was it is basically N-allyl norepinephrine, okay, chemically. Okay, and when it was discovered, it could reverse the actions of morphine. Okay, so it was introduced as an opioid antagonist, but then later on it was found that it also has agonistic property at the kappa receptor also. Okay, so it's not a pure antagonist, okay, so it was not effective, quite effective in reversing all the actions of morphine because of this property, kappa agonistic property. Okay, so because of this kappa agonistic property, it also had analgesic property also, but it was of lower ceiling as compared to morphine. So it was not as much efficacious as morphine in producing that analgesia, which was mainly because of its interaction and stimulation or agonistic property at the kappa receptor. But this particular drug has gone out of use. That's because when this drug was used repeatedly, it progressed to the dysphoria. Okay, so dysphoric effects were produced, that is a sense of dislike. Okay, so it produced certain behavioral changes. So also it had psychotomimetic effects, that is it precipitated psychotic like conditions in these individuals. So that's how, because of these adverse effects, this drug nalorphine has gone out of use. It is no longer used now. Okay, then the next drug is pentazocin. Now this particular drug has a weak mu antagonistic action. Okay, but it has a more marked kappa agonistic action. Okay, so no doubt it blocks the mu receptor. Okay, but that blockage is not very much effective. It's only a weak blocker of the mu receptor, but it has more selective action towards kappa agonistic property. That is, it could bind to the kappa receptors, kappa opioid receptors, and stimulate them. Okay, so this particular drug has properties similar to that of morphine, but effects were mediated through the kappa receptor because it rather blocked the mu receptor, which is actually the main receptor through which morphine is producing its action. So some of the properties are similar to that of morphine, but there are some important differences in between these two drugs. Like say for example, the mechanism by which this analgesia is produced. Now of course, since pentazocin interacts with the kappa receptors and it has agonistic property, so kappa receptors also have analgesic property, right? When kappa receptors are stimulated, and mainly we have seen under the types of receptors that kappa receptors, they generally produce the spinal analgesia at the spinal level. Okay, so this analgesia which was caused is at the spinal level, and it is mediated mainly through the kappa 1 receptor, whereas morphine, it mainly produces analgesic activity by interaction mainly through the mu receptor. Okay, then another difference is the potency. Okay, now if you can compare the equianalgesic doses, that is the dose which produces the same amount of analgesia, if you can see, for pentazocin 30 milligrams is required and for morphine 10 milligrams is required. Okay, so it indicates that pentazocin is less potent. It is 3 times less potent because 3 times more dose is required, okay, to produce the same amount of analgesia when both of them are used parenterally. So this indicates that pentazocin is less potent as compared to morphine. Then the sedation and the respiratory depression. We have seen that morphine is having very much prominent sedative and respiratory depression property. But if you can say with the pentazocin, it is 1/3 to half of that of morphine. Okay, so it is not very much prominent in producing sedation or respiratory depression. Also, these effects are of lower ceiling. Okay, so maximum sedation or respiratory depression, if you can compare with both these drugs, the depression which is produced or the sedation which is produced by pentazocin, it is not that severe like what it is produced with that of morphine. Okay, another difference is tachycardia and rise in BP is produced with this particular drug pentazocin. Okay, that's because of the sympathetic stimulation. Okay, whereas exactly opposite effects were produced by morphine, we have seen. So under morphine, we have seen that morphine is actually used in left ventricular failure, right? Even in the myocardial infarction also, it has anti-ischemic property also. Okay, it reduces the amount of work which is done by the heart. Okay, but exactly opposite is happening with this drug pentazocin. It is actually increasing the cardiac work. So it is contraindicated in any kind of cardiovascular condition, maybe ischemia or myocardial infarction, it is totally contraindicated. So this is another major difference. Apart from that, biliary spasm and the constipation which is produced by this drug is less severe as compared to morphine. Also, vomiting is a very common side effect seen with the morphine. So this is also less frequent with the pentazocin. Apart from that, some other side effects also are produced with this drug, pentazocin, that is sweating and lightheadedness are also seen. Then the next difference is subjective effect, or the pleasurable effect, or the sense of well-being which is obtained. So it is similar to that of morphine. Okay, so abuse liability is seen with this drug also, and it is seen even at lower doses. Okay, so it is more efficient in producing the behavioral changes, or to produce the reinforcing effects in the individual, so that the person may become dependent on this particular drug. Now supposing if you give this drug to some post addicts, so who are already drug addicts on opioids, supposing if you give this drug in such individuals, so they will recognize this drug as an opiate. Okay, so they will identify it as similar to that of opioid, but it is not a full agonist actually. Okay, but still they will think, or they will identify it as if they have been given an opioid. Now, though it produces the pleasurable effects, still as the dose increases, as you go on increasing the dose, okay, so these effects, the pleasurable effects, will rather turn out to be into unpleasant ones, and psychotomimetic effects also start appearing. Okay, so this is quite peculiarly seen with this drug. Morphine does not produce such kind of effects. Okay, then upon repeated use, so these are all the differences. Now, upon repeated use, this drug also produces tolerance, then psychological and physical dependence, okay, just like morphine produces, okay, with the repeated use. Then withdrawal symptoms, okay, withdrawal symptoms meaning if you suddenly stop the treatment, so withdrawal symptoms will be produced because physical dependence is seen, so certain symptoms will be precipitated. So the symptoms which are seen over here in the form of withdrawal syndrome, okay, when this treatment is stopped, these are similar to that of morphine and nalorphine withdrawal symptoms, okay, but these are mild in intensity as compared to those which are seen with withdrawal symptoms of morphine and nalorphine. Then drug seeking behavior is there, okay, since it has psychological dependence, it produces sense of well-being, okay, we have seen, which is comparable to that of morphine. So this drug has abuse liability. Okay, so drug seeking behavior is seen over here, so person may want to take that drug again and again, even if it is not required, okay, because just to derive the pleasure or euphoria out of it. So abuse liability is seen with this drug also upon repeated use, but it is rated lower than that of morphine. Okay, so it is not as high as that of morphine, or as severe as that of morphine. And suppose if you inject this drug in morphine dependent subject, so those who are already become dependent on morphine, and suppose you inject this particular drug in such individuals, it will start precipitating the withdrawal symptoms of that of morphine also, because it can slightly antagonize the mu receptor, and we have seen that morphine mainly acts through the mu receptor, so we have seen that it has a weak mu antagonistic property also. It is rated 1/5 as that of nalorphine in blocking the mu receptor. So no doubt it will precipitate the withdrawal symptoms, okay, but it is not enough to be used in treatment of morphine poisoning. Okay, so if morphine poisoning has taken place, this is not the selective antagonist or antidote, okay, because all the actions are not effectively reversed by this particular agent, because it has only partial antagonistic property or weak antagonistic property at mu receptor, so not effective in morphine poisoning as such. Okay, then coming to the pharmacokinetics of pentazocin, it is effective orally. Again, this is one more difference. Morphine, we have seen that oral bioavailability is not very good, high first pass metabolism is seen over there, whereas first pass metabolism is seen with pentazocin also, but comparatively it has a better oral to parenteral ratio, it is 1:3. Okay, so it is comparatively better effective by oral route. If you can see the metabolizing processes, it is metabolized in the liver with the help of oxidation reaction of glucuronide conjugation, and the metabolites are excreted in the urine. The plasma T half life of this drug is 3 to 4 hours, and the duration of action, that is action after the single dose, lasts for 4 to 6 hours. So it is quite comparable to that of morphine. Then coming to the uses, this drug is used for post operative or moderately severe pain, which is seen in burns, trauma, fractures, cancer and all. Okay, but it should not be used in cases where prolonged treatment is required. Okay, so chronic pain, it is not suitable to be used for chronic pain. That's because it can, you know, precipitate dysphoria or psychotomimetic effects. So prolonged use is not advisable. Only short lasting acute type of pain can be controlled effectively. Okay, then the next drug is butorphanol. Now this is again in kappa analgesic. Okay, so it has agonistic property at the kappa receptors, so that's how it has analgesic property. But when you compare it with pentazocin, it is more potent. If you can see, the comparison is given over here. 2 milligrams of butorphanol produces equivalent effect similar to pentazocin used in 30 milligram dose. Okay, so it is round about 15 times more potent as compared to pentazocin. Okay, if you compare it with morphine, analgesia and respiratory depression, these are of lower scale, not as severe as that of morphine. Okay, then the side effects such as sedation, nausea, cardiac stimulation, so all such kind of side effects, these are similar to that of pentazocin. Okay, but if you can see that dysphoric effects, okay, these are less as compared to pentazocin. We have seen that pentazocin cannot be used for a prolonged treatment, okay, because dysphoria or psychotomimetic effects can be precipitated. So that disadvantage is not seen with this particular agent, because it is less likely to precipitate dysphoria or psychotomimetic effects also. Okay, and if you give this drug to post addicts, they will recognize it as a barbiturate rather than as an opiate. We have seen with the earlier drug, when you inject it in a morphine dependent patient, they will identify it as an opioid. Okay, but patients over here, or the addicts, they recognize this drug rather as a barbiturate, and mostly the effects are unpleasant, so they dislike, they don't want to take this drug. Okay, again, so because unpleasant effects are produced, the disadvantage is that it produces physical dependence also. Okay, and withdrawal can be precipitated by high doses of naloxone. Supposing if you inject naloxone in such individuals, okay, then it can start precipitating the withdrawal symptoms. Also, abuse potential is there with this particular drug, but it is rated low. It has low degree of abuse liability. Okay, so it is quite safer upon repeated use. Okay. Then another feature with this particular agent is that it can neither substitute for nor antagonize the morphine. Okay, so it will not be able to use, you know, in the addicts as a substituent agent, nor it can antagonize the actions of morphine. So it is not effective as an, you know, antidote in case of morphine poisoning. The reason behind this is that it has a very weak interaction with the mu receptors. Okay, so it has a very weak mu antagonistic property. So that's the reason why these uses cannot be, you know, advocated. Rather, it is used for post-operative pain or other short-lasting pain like renal colic. Okay, so such patients it can be used, but it should be avoided in cardiac ischemia. So those who are suffering from some kind of cardiovascular conditions, it is supposed to be contraindicated in such individuals. Then the T half life and the duration, it is similar to that of morphine. And coming to the next drug, that is buprenorphine. Now this particular drug, it is highly lipid soluble. Okay, so it can cross the blood-brain barrier very effectively, and the mu analgesic property, okay, it has, and it is 25 times more potent than morphine. Okay, so it has agonistic property at mu receptors. Okay, so it produces analgesia by interaction through the mu receptors over here. Earlier, the first class we have seen that they have mu antagonistic property and they had kappa agonistic property that was responsible for the spinal analgesia. But this particular drug buprenorphine, okay, it has mu agonistic property, okay, and it is 25 times more potent than that of morphine. Okay, but intrinsic activity and ceiling effect, if you can see, it is lower as compared to morphine. Then the analgesia, it produces quick analgesia, okay, but it is short lasting. Analgesia will last only for 6 to 8 hours. But this drug has cumulative property. That is, over a period of time, if you go on repeating the treatment, okay, after repeated use, the duration of action will increase round up to 24 hours. That's because it can accumulate in the tissues. It has cumulative property. So it can go and bind to the tissue proteins and it will remain over there for a longer period of time. So that upon repeated use, the T half-life or the duration of action even increases to 24 hours. Then coming to the side effects, these are similar to that of morphine, okay, sedation, vomiting, miosis, subjective, okay, or mood changes, and the cardiovascular effects, all are similar to that of morphine, but constipation is less marked when you compare it with morphine. Okay. Then postural hypotension with this drug is more prominent, more likely to produce the postural hypotension. Okay, so that is in the standing position, it is more likely to produce the fall in the. Then this is a peculiar use with this particular drug. It substitutes for morphine at low levels in case of morphine dependence. So low levels of morphine dependence, it can be substituted for morphine. But supposing if the person is highly dependent upon the morphine, so in that case it will start precipitating the withdrawal symptom. So in mild cases you can use as a substituent therapy in case if you want that person to leave that habit. But if at all the person is highly dependent upon morphine, such a substitutive use of this drug is not possible. Rather it will start precipitating the withdrawal symptoms. Okay, that's because it has partial agonistic property at the mu receptor. You know, it does not have very much or very high degree of mu agonistic property. Okay, it's only partially agonistic. Okay, apart from that, we have seen in the name of the class that it also has antagonistic property on the kappa receptor. So all the actions mediated through the kappa receptors can be blocked by this particular drug. Apart from that, tolerance, physical and psychological dependence also develops through this particular drug upon chronic use. If you use this drug repeatedly, all these features can be precipitated. Then the withdrawal syndrome. If you suddenly stop the treatment, then withdrawal syndrome may be precipitated, which can be similar to that of morphine. Okay, but it is milder comparatively. Drug-seeking behavior with this particular drug also, it is present, but abuse liability is lower as compared to that of morphine. So it is not quite effective in producing behavioral changes compared to that of morphine. So it has drug-seeking behavior, but abuse liability is less likely with this particular drug. Okay. Naloxone can be used to prevent the effects. Okay. Now, though it can be used as an antagonist, okay, but if you can see that naloxone can only prevent the effects of buprenorphine. Okay. But supposing like how naloxone is an antagonist of the mu receptor. So in case of morphine poisoning, you can give naloxone. So it will antagonize all the actions of morphine. Okay, but here in this case, naloxone cannot reverse the actions which are produced by buprenorphine. Morphine, like only it can prevent, prophylactically you can give it before, okay, but once if buprenorphine is given, it is not effectively able to reverse the action later on. That's because buprenorphine binds to this receptor more tightly, so naloxone is not able to replace it. Okay, so it cannot reverse the action, but only naloxone can prevent the actions which can be produced by buprenorphine. Then coming to the pharmacokinetics, this drug has good efficacy by sublingual route, okay, not it is not very good by oral route but sublingual route. Okay, so you need to keep it beneath the tongue and then it will be absorbed from the buccal mucosa. Okay, plasma protein binding also quite high. Okay, and it remains in the tissue for several days. Okay, so it will remain bound in the tissue proteins, okay, for over a period of time. So that if you can see the T half life is 40 hours. Okay, so it is quite a long acting agent, and ultimately it is excreted in the unchanged form in the bile. Okay, so ultimately it will be excreted out of the body in the feces. It is not undergoing any kind of metabolism. It is mostly excreted in the unchanged form. Coming to the uses, it is indicated for the long-lasting painful conditions, okay, which are requiring the opioid analgesics, like cancer pain. Apart from that, it can be used as a pre-medication, okay, or post-operative pain also can be relieved. Then myocardial infarction, okay, and in the treatment of morphine dependence, but that too low level of dependence, not highly dependent individuals. Then coming to the last class, that is pure opioid antagonist. So all these drugs can only block the opioid receptor. They don't have any agonistic property. Okay, so this first drug, that is naloxone, which is quite popularly used as a specific antidote for opioid poisoning, okay, specifically for the morphine poisoning it is used. Okay, so it's an N-allyl noroxymorphone. It's a competitive antagonist. Okay, so it competes with the agonist for the site, okay, and it will block the receptors. Okay, all the type of opioid receptors can be blocked, but within those three receptors, mu, kappa and delta, if you can see that mu receptor blockage, it takes place at much lower doses than what is required to block the kappa and delta receptors. So this shows that it has high tendency to block the or antagonize the mu receptors. Okay, so that is the reason why this is a specific antidote for the morphine, because morphine specifically produces its action which are mediated through mu receptors. Okay, so naloxone has more efficacy towards blocking the mu receptors. No doubt it can block kappa as well as delta receptors, but a little bit higher doses are required. Then no subjective or autonomic effects are produced in individuals who have already taken the opioids. Suppose in such individuals who have never received any opioid. So in such individuals, subjective effects or autonomic effects are not generated. Physical, psychological dependence or withdrawal symptoms are also not seen with this particular agent. Okay? Then injected by IV route, this can antagonize all the actions of morphine. That's because it has higher tendency to block the mu receptors. So analgesia, which is produced by morphine, that is gone. So that will be abolished. Okay, respiratory depressive action is produced by morphine. So here respiration will not only normalize, but rather this drug will stimulate the respiration. Pupils will start dilating. We are seeing with morphine, meiosis takes place, right? So pinpoint pupil is the characteristic feature or the symptom of the morphine poisoning. So this drug reverses the action, it produces the pupil dilatation. However, sedation, which is produced by morphine, so it is less completely reversed by this naloxone, and this is the dose in which it is used, okay, 4 to 10 milligrams, okay, specifically given in the parenteral doses. Okay, so it can effectively antagonize all the actions of morphine as well as of nalorphine, pentazocin and all. Okay, so all the agonistic properties will be antagonized or opposed by this particular agent. However, just in the previous drug, we have seen that actions of buprenorphine, these can only be prevented. Okay, that's because buprenorphine binds to that receptor very strongly. Okay, so naloxone is not able to replace it. So rather, naloxone can only prevent the actions of buprenorphine, but it cannot effectively reverse the actions of buprenorphine. Already, if buprenorphine is bound to the mu receptors, it's not able to replace it. So it can only be used to prevent, not to reverse the action of the buprenorphine. So except for buprenorphine poisoning, all the other opioid poisoning, this naloxone can be effectively used. Okay. then naloxone when injected, it can also precipitate morphine, nalorphine, pentazocine withdrawal symptoms also. In such individuals who are taking these drugs, in them if you inject this naloxone, all the effects will be reversed. So it will start precipitating the withdrawal symptoms in such individuals. Not only that, now so far we have seen that naloxone can antagonize all the actions produced by the drugs which bind and act through the opioid receptor. But not only that, naloxone can also block the actions of endogenous opioid peptides also, which is the next part which we are going to cover. So there are certain opioid peptides, certain peptides which are found in the body endogenously, they are present in the body normally, which can also interact with the opioid receptor and produce similar actions. Okay, so those actions which are produced by these endogenous opioid peptides, these can also be blocked by naloxone very effectively. Okay. Apart from that, it can also antagonize the respiratory depression which is produced by certain known opioids. Now, nitrous oxide or diazepam, okay, so we have seen that they don't interact with any opioid receptor. But still, this drug can reverse the respiratory depression which may be produced by these drugs also effectively. Okay. Coming to the pharmacokinetics, naloxone, it is ineffective orally. Okay, because very high first pass metabolism is seen in the liver. So, as such, it is not effective by oral route, it has to be given by parenteral route. Mostly it is given by IV route because it is used as an antidote for the poisoning of opiates. So, it is a drug of emergency, okay, to reverse all the actions. So it is injected and immediately it can reverse all the actions. Metabolism, it takes place mainly by glucuronide conjugation, okay, and the T half-life, it varies. Okay, in the adults as well as in the newborn. In adults it is just 1 hour, whereas in case of newborns it is 3 hours. That's because glucuronidation is not well developed in the small baby. So it will not get metabolized very effectively or at a normal rate. So T half-life is little bit longer in the newborn babies. Okay. Then adverse effects with this drug are also not, severe or significant. Only rise in BP and pulmonary edema may take place. So not very much significant side effects are produced. And coming to the uses, okay, so naloxone, as I have already discussed in the actions, it is a drug of choice for morphine poisoning and also for reversing the neonatal asphyxia. Okay, so the depression, respiratory depression in the neonates can also be reversed by this particular the drug. Okay, so opioids when they are used during the labor, okay, so it can affect the baby. Okay, we have seen that opioids they can effectively affect the baby more than the mother. That's what we have seen. Okay, so if at all it is used in some kind of obstetric procedures, these opioids are used, it may produce the neonatal asphyxia. So that can also be reversed by naloxone very effectively. So it's a drug of choice. So this is the first line treatment for such condition, morphine poisoning as well as neonatal asphyxia. So also this is used to treat the overdose of other opioids or agonist, antagonist, okay, except buprenorphine. Okay, the reasons we have seen, it can only prevent but it cannot reverse the action. Otherwise all the agonist, antagonist actions can be reversed by this particular agent. Apart from that, there are certain other uses also. It can be used to reverse the respiratory depression, which may be caused due to the use of intraoperative opioids. Then it can be used as an adjunct to intraspinal opioid analgesia. Then next use is diagnosis of opioid dependence. That is to find out whether the person is dependent on opioid. So what will happen if you inject this drug? We have seen under the actions also. So when this drug is injected in those who are dependent on the opioids, it will start precipitating the withdrawal symptom. So it will be helpful to find out whether the person is addicted to such kind of opioids or is dependent on the opioids. Then apart from this, it can reverse the alcohol intoxication also. Okay, apart from reversing the opioid actions, it can also reverse the alcohol intoxication also. Then it elevates the BP in endotoxic or hypovolemic shock, stroke or spinal injury. So this will be other uses. Then the next drug is naltrexone. Now this drug is more potent as compared to naloxone, but there are certain differences.
So this drug differs from naloxone in being orally active, where we have seen that naloxone is not active by oral route, right? It has to be given only by the parenteral route. Specifically, IV route is preferred for that. Okay, but this drug, it is orally active. It can be given by oral route also. Plus, it has a long duration of action. Okay, so now because of this long duration of action, it is used as a substitute therapy. Okay, in the addicts, those who have become dependent on the opioids. So it is given as a substitute therapy. Okay, so what is done is over here, 50 milligrams per day dose is selected, and it is given orally to such individuals. So subjective effects are not produced when this drug is given. Okay, so after when this drug naltrexone is given to a particular addict, okay, or who is dependent on the opioids. After this administration of this drug, if the person takes the opioid analgesics or the opioids, okay, because these persons are addicts, so they will tend to take these opioids again and again. So supposing after this naltrexone they take the opioids, no subjective effects are produced. Okay, that is those behavioral changes or sense of well-being which they get after taking morphine or any other opioid. So they will not get that pleasurable effect. So also craving will be subsided. That is, supposing if these addicts don't get the drug, you know, they will start craving for that. You know, they will want that drug very badly, so that they will be, you know, ready to go to any particular level. Okay, so that craving effect, that also subsides because of the substitute therapy to this particular agent. So also it is, it can reduce the alcohol craving also. Okay, so those who are dependent on alcohol, in such individuals also craving for alcohol after the withdrawal of this alcohol consumption. So that can also be effectively reduced, so that it can prevent relapse of heavy drinking. So those who are heavy drinkers who have become dependent on alcohol, in such individuals also it will be helpful in leaving their habit. Okay. And coming to the side effects, these are nausea and headache. Whereas high doses can also precipitate dependent toxicity. So this is quite problematic. This is the limitation with the use of this particular agent. Okay. The next drug is nalmefene. Okay, so this drug is advantageous in being hepatotoxic problem. It does not have any hepatotoxic property. Okay, just like naltrexone has. That's a limitation with this particular drug. But such property is absent with nalmefene. Also, higher oral bioavailability is seen with this particular drug, and also it is longer acting. So these are some of the advantages. Rest properties remain the same. And the next drug is methyl naltrexone. Okay, so as the name implies, it's a derivative of naltrexone. Okay, but the difference is that it does not penetrate the blood-brain barrier because it is not highly lipid soluble. It cannot cross the blood-brain barrier, but it can effectively block the peripheral actions of mu opioids. So basically, it will not reverse the actions of your opioids in the CNS, but rather they will block the peripheral actions of these opioids. Like mainly it is used to reverse the constipation. Okay, now we have seen that opioids, the major problem is the constipation. When chronically these drugs are administered, they can produce distressing constipation. Now chronic administration of these opioids may have to be given in the cancer patients. Okay, so they are chronically ill and they suffer from severe pain. So to combat that pain, these opioid analgesics are preferably given. But the thing is, it can precipitate constipation. Okay, so these cancer patients can be constipated. Okay, so to reverse this constipation, this drug can be utilized. Okay, so it will not affect its analgesic property, but the only thing is it can reverse the constipating problem. So those who are on the chronic analgesic treatment, okay, chronic opioid analgesic treatment, or those who are taking methadone for maintenance therapy, in such individuals these side effects can be reversed by this drug, methyl naltrexone. So this finishes the opioid complex action opioids and opioid antagonists. Now the next small part is endogenous opioid peptides. Okay, so as I've already told you all earlier, there are few peptides which are found in the body. Okay, so these are similar to that of morphine. They produce action similar to that of morphine. Okay, so in 1970s, it was discovered that there are certain peptides which are found in the body. They were isolated from mammalian brain, pituitary gland, and the spinal cord and GIT. So these peptides were shown to have similar actions like that of morphine. Okay, so these were active in very small doses. Okay, then their actions were also blocked by naloxone. This point we have also covered under this drug. This naloxone can effectively block the actions of these endogenous opioid peptides. Okay, so also they can bind with very high affinity to the opioid receptors. So they can bind and stimulate these opioid receptors so that similar actions are produced by these endogenous opioid peptides also. So basically many of these opioid peptides have been discovered. Okay, and there are basically these are divided into three different families. Okay, they are grouped into three different families. Okay, so each of these families is categorized depending upon what is the source from which these opioid peptides are derived. Okay, what is the precursor for that? So accordingly, it has been classified into three families. Okay, coming to the first one, which is known as endorphins. Okay, out of these, the main one is the beta endorphin. This is the accepted short form for this. Okay, so it's a 31 amino acid. It's a peptide, right? So it will be made up of amino acids. Okay, so it has 31 amino acids. Okay, and this one, beta endorphin. There are others also, of course, but this is the most important one out of all the endorphins. Okay, and the precursor from which this is obtained. Okay, or it is generated as pro-opio-melanocortin. POMC is the accepted short form for that. Now this precursor, it's a large molecule actually. Okay, so it produces not only beta endorphin, but apart from that it also produces gamma MSH, melanocyte stimulating hormone, ACTH also is produced, adrenocorticotropic hormone, and two other lipotropins are also generated from this same precursor, pro-opio-melanocortin. And if you can see the affinity, okay, of these beta endorphins, it has out of all these opioid receptors, the three opioid receptors, if you can compare the actions, it is having more affinity towards the mu receptor. So it is basically acting as a mu agonist. Of course, it has delta agonistic property also, but comparatively it is having more selectivity towards the mu receptor. And kappa activity is very, very less with this particular agent. The next is enkephalins. Okay, enkephalins. Now there are two main enkephalins which have been discovered. Methionine enkephalin, accordingly it is named like that. MEK is accepted short form. And the second one is leucine enkephalin. Okay, so accordingly the short forms are given. Okay, so both of these are pentapeptides, and the precursor from which it is derived is proenkephalin. This is the source from which it is derived. Now, this particular proenkephalin, it gives rise to four methionine enkephalin and one leucine enkephalin residue. Okay, so it's a large peptide which can give rise to four methionine enkephalin and one leucine enkephalin. Okay, and these enkephalins, okay, they have high affinity towards the delta opioid receptor. Less of mu receptor interaction and very less kappa interaction. Mainly they interact with the delta receptor. Okay, then the third family is dynorphins. Now over here again there are two, dynorphin A and dynorphin B. Accordingly these are the short forms which can be used. So they contain 8 to 17 amino acid peptides. Then it is derived from prodynorphin. This is the source from which it is obtained. Now, apart from giving rise to this dynorphin, this prodynorphin, it can also generate three molecules of leucine enkephalins also. And these dynorphins, these have affinity towards the kappa receptor. In the earlier two cases, we have seen they have very weak kappa action, right? But these dynorphins, basically, they interact with the kappa receptor and they have very weak mu and delta actions. Okay? So, this is the distribution. Okay, where exactly the precursors from which these the opioid peptides are derived from. So these are the locations. Okay, so propiomelanocortin. So it is basically found in the areas which are supplying the limbic areas or medulla, anterior pituitary, the pancreatic islets. So we can see basically this modulates the hormonal release. Okay, then the next one, that is proencephalin. Okay, so this is found in the pain areas of the spinal as well as supraspinal areas. Okay, limbic system. Okay, then the cortex, medulla, hypothalamus, adrenal medulla, gastric and intestinal glands. So it has a wide distribution, right? So encephalins are found at a wider regions in your body. Similarly, prodiamorphin. These also have wide distribution, similar to that of proencephalin. Okay, but the types of neurons in which it is distributed, it is a little bit different. The same areas it is distributed, but the type of neurons in which it is found is slightly different. So these are the areas where exactly these different classes of opioid peptides are found. Okay, so all these opioid peptides together, they constitute an endogenous opioid system. Okay, so till now we have studied all the opioid drugs, complex action opioids. So these are all drugs, right, that can be administered and that can be, you know, utilized for their therapeutic properties or their antagonistic property, which can interact with the opioid receptor. But there are certain endogenous peptides also which collectively form a opioid system. Okay, so our body also has its own opioid system, which is actually mediating the various functions by interacting through these opioid receptors. Okay, so normally the pain perception, they modulate the pain perception. Okay, the mood changes, hedonic, that is pleasurable effects, or motor behavior. Okay, then the emesis, pituitary hormone release, or gastric motility. So all these are mediated endogenous. So they are helping in the normal physiology at all these levels, all these endogenous peptides which are found. Okay, roughly if you can see beta endorphins. Okay, so these decrease the LH and FSH levels. Okay, so release is decreased. Then growth hormone and prolactin levels are increased. It increases the release. Okay, so also these encephalins and dynorphins. So they have very wide distribution. So they could be playing a very important role in neuromodulator or as to control the neurotransmitter. Okay, so that various functions can be, you know, controlled, like regulation of the pain responsiveness at spinal or supraspinal levels, because they are found at the areas of which control the pain at the spinal level as well as at the supraspinal level in the higher areas. Okay. Then these opioid peptides also are, you know, they are believed to be regulating the behavior, okay, or affective behavior or the autonomic functions also, because they are found in such areas also, okay, hypothalamus and all. So in such areas they could be producing that behavioral changes also, okay, which normally found in the person. Now apart from all these opioid peptides, recently a new opioid peptide also has been discovered, okay, that is known as nociceptin, or it is also known as orphanin FQ, okay, which has been recently found in the mammalian brain. Okay, so it is found in areas like cortex, hippocampus, in the spinal cord, and in certain sensory sites also. So the role in these particular areas is stress response or reward or reinforcing effects. Learning and memory could also be improved because of this nociceptin. A specific type of receptor has also been identified, which is known as nociceptin receptor or orphanin FQ receptor, through which this particular nociceptin will bind and it will produce its action. Okay, so this is now known as nociceptin opioid peptide receptor. So this finishes your chapter. The important questions pertaining to this particular chapter. So this includes classification of the opioids as well as the complex action opioid and antagonist. Both are important. Then the pharmacology of morphine. This is very, very important from exam point of view. Okay, many times the questions have appeared on this morphine. So it's very, very important. Morphine as well as opioid poisoning is also very important from exam point of view. You need to discuss the symptoms which can be precipitated and the treatment the treatment lines, how the naloxone, in what dose it has to be given and all. Okay, then questions like compare and contrast between any two drugs. We have seen so many points of differences, like mostly the drug is being compared with morphine. Okay, so you need to know. So such question be asked like compare and contrast between morphine and pethidine. Okay, so such type of questions can also be asked specifically for 2 marks. Okay, then a note on opioid antagonist may also be asked.